Today, I have the privilege of speaking with Vince Beiser. Vince is an award-winning journalist who's based in Vancouver, Canada. Vince is a reporter from over 100 countries, states, provinces, kingdoms, occupied territories, liberated areas, no man's lands, and disaster zones. He's exposed conditions in California's harshest prisons, trained his troops bound for Iraq, ridden with first responders to disasters in Haiti and Nepal, and hunted down other stories from around the world for publications, including, among many, Wired, The Atlantic, The Guardian, The New York Times, and The Atlantic. His first book, which we discuss extensively today, The World in a Grain, Story of How Sand and How It Transformed Civilization, was a finalist for Penn Wilson Award and a California Book Award. Vince is different than most journalists. He looks where others do not. Because of this, he grants deep insight into subjects that are sparsely explored. In other words, he's an intellectual frontiersman. I hope you enjoy this conversation with Vince Beiser. Hey, how's it going?
It's going good.
Going good.
It's going good. How about yourself?
I'm doing great. I first wanted to ask you, start off and say, so how did you become a journalist? How did you start in your career?
Oh, you want to go all the way back there?
Yeah.
Pretty much by accident, really. What happened was, how did it happen? So I went to the University of California at Berkeley and didn't really know quite what I wanted to do, but I did a year abroad in Egypt, which got me really interested and sort of connected with the Israeli-Palestinian issue. So by the time I graduated, I was, you know, I was very sort of caught up with that, and you know, I spoke some Arabic and really wanted to do something to, you know, fix it, see if I could just like solve that little problem. So when I graduated, I just took myself over to Jerusalem, to East Jerusalem, to the Arab side of Jerusalem, and just started looking around for a job, you know, something that, something to, you know, get me involved with it all. And the first thing that came my way was a job with a Palestinian news agency. Yeah, Yasser Arafat's mother-in-law was my very first boss in journalism. So, yeah, and it turned out that, you know, the only real skills that I had at that point were, you know, I was good at, college had taught me how to gather up lots of information and sort of boil it down into, you know, distill it down to something short and readable. And I was really curious and really, you know, adventurous, just kind of wanted to get out there and be in the middle of everything and be where all the action was happening. This was the middle of the first Intifada in the early 1990s, when there was a lot of violence going on every day all across the West Bank and Gaza, fighting between Palestinians and Israelis. So anyway, it just turned out that, you know, all those things are what journalists do. So it just turned out to be a good fit for me. So working there, I sort of got a good, started to learn about the business and got to work with some, you know, a lot of foreign journalists would come through and work with us, work with the agency that I was connected with, this local Palestinian outfit. So I got to, you know, just kind of see how the business operates and liked it, thought it was, you know, had the potential to do some good in the world. And, you know, I've just been stuck ever since.
So how did you go from there to writing an entire book about sand, which I think is a very interesting topic, because when I first heard about you, I had heard about, I just came across some video that was talking about how sand is this limited natural resource that is actually quite quite important to civilization, especially our modern one, as it's growing so fast, and you have developing countries that are building like so fast. And I came across your book and I was just like, it just really blew me away how important this sand actually is. So can you just first talk about what made you get into writing about sand as a concept?
Sure. I mean, it's right. It seems like the most unlikely topic in the world, right? Mm-hmm. But basically, I'm a full-time freelancer, so I'm always hustling around for good story ideas, for, you know, for important stories that other folks have overlooked or that have been undercovered. And I like international issues a lot, so I read quite a bit of foreign press. And one day, I mean, it's about 5-6 years ago by now already, I just ran across this story in an Indian newspaper about this farmer in India who had been murdered over sand. And I just thought, what in the world? Like, why would anybody get killed over sand of all things? Like, who cares about sand? It seems like the most trivial thing in the world. So I started looking into it, and come to find out, not only had this one guy been murdered over sand, but hundreds of people have been killed because of sand in the last few years. And the reason is, as you know, like you just mentioned, is because it's actually the most important solid substance on Earth. It's the raw material that our cities are made out of. And I can explain more about that if you want. But basically, you know, I sort of realized that, realized how incredibly important sand is, realized that there's so much demand for it in today's world because we are building cities so fast and on such a huge scale that it's creating these shortages, and we're doing massive environmental damage to get at the sand we need. In some places, like in India, a black market has arisen where, you know, organized crime gangs are killing people who try to get in their way or fighting between themselves over sand. And this is happening really all over the world. And it really blew my mind. I had no idea. And I thought, you know, this is a really important subject that almost nobody is talking about. And that makes it a good story for me.
Yeah. So what is sand actually used for? If you can explain, what is it actually used for?
Sure. So we use sand for all kinds of things. I mean, wherever you're sitting right now, you're almost certainly sitting in sand. The floor beneath you, the walls around you, the roof over your head, almost certainly made with concrete, or at least partly with concrete. Just like every modern building in the world today, every shopping mall, office tower, apartment block, you name it, is made at least partly with concrete. So what's concrete? Well, concrete is just sand and gravel that's been glued together, right? So every building, if you look out your window in any city in the world today, all those buildings you're looking at are basically enormous piles of sand. All the roads that connect all those buildings, also made of sand, right? Roads are made out of concrete or asphalt. And asphalt, again, is just a slightly different version of sand that's been glued together. The windows in all those buildings, also made of sand. Every piece of glass on Earth is just sand that's been melted down to form glass. The silicon chips that power our computers and our cell phones, also made from sand. And it goes on and on. We use sand in things like toothpaste, in winemaking, in elastics, in breast implants, all kinds of crazy things. So the number of ways that sand is important to our lives are vast and are many. But the number one thing by far that we use it for is concrete, right? Our world today is really based on concrete, not just cities, but dams, roads, highways, airport runways. The whole infrastructure of the modern world is built almost entirely out of concrete. We use so much concrete every single year. We could build a wall 90 feet high and 90 feet wide right the way around the equator every single year. So that's how crucial concrete is. And again, concrete is basically made from sand. And it seems crazy to think, well, how could we possibly be running out of something like sand, right? It's everywhere. There's so much of it. And of course, yeah, there's a lot of sand in the world, but we use 50 billion tons of sand and gravel every single year. That's enough to cover the entire state of California. When you're talking about using anything in that amount, you're going to run into some problems. You're going to create some problems, and you're going to start to, sooner or later, you're going to start to run out.
Yeah. Can you, that you're about to touch on it, can you go into more depth about what sand is specifically needed? Because you think sand, you have a desert full of sand, that's a hard desert. You have giant tons and thousands of tons of sand. How could you be running out of sand?
Right. Great question. So the problem is all that sand in the deserts is basically useless to us. And the reason is that the actual grains are the wrong shape. So your desert sand grains have been eroded by wind over thousands and millions of years. The wind's been kicking them around, knocking them around all over the desert. And that's eroded those desert sand grains to where they're quite smooth and round if you look at them up really close. And that sand just doesn't work to make concrete, which is the number one thing that we use sand for. What you need is the sand that's been eroded by water, the sand that you find at the bottom of rivers, lakes, on beaches. Those grains are much more angular. They've got more sharp edges and corners, so they lock together to form a solid structure much better. Makes for much, much stronger concrete. It's like the difference between trying to build something out of a huge pile of marbles, your desert sand, versus a huge pile of little bricks, which is your water eroded sand. So all that sand in the desert's off the table, totally useless to us. The sand that we need, again, is the stuff that you find in riverbeds, lake beds, beaches, land areas where there used to be rivers and so on. And sure enough, there's a lot of that sand out there. But again, the amounts that we're using are just not sustainable.
Yeah. So the sand that you're talking about is essentially, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like it's like fresh sand. Like the water is eroding away like rocks and such. So it's going to be a lot more freshly broken up, correct?
Well, relatively speaking, I mean, we're talking about in geologic terms, right?
Yeah.
We're still talking about grains that are, you know, that were probably broken off. So let me step back for a quick second, just explain where that sand comes from in the first place. So first of all, sand can be anything, right? The word itself just means small pieces of any hard substance, right? So sand can be any kind of rock. It can be crushed up shells, right? Like in the Caribbean, sometimes you get those pink sand beaches. Those are basically made of crushed up shells rather than rock. That's why they have that color. But most of the sand in the world, and the sand that we use mostly, that we're most concerned about is quartz. It's a very hard kind of rock. And where those quartz sand grains come from is mountains. Basically, you have mountains and other geologic formations, great big rocks that are constantly being eroded, worn away by the wind and the rain that's constantly breaking off little pieces of those. The rain washes those grains down into rivers. Rivers carry them down the sides of mountains and across the land and out to the ocean. So that process, by the time we're, that process takes, you know, thousands or even sometimes millions of years. So the grains of sand that we're using, you know, in geologic terms, they're relatively fresh, but that's, you know, at the least, they're still thousands and thousands of years old.
So back to the sand you being used today, how did sand originally start to be mined? Where did the industry develop?
So we've been using sand, human beings have been using sand in construction, I mean, really as far back as history goes. The ancient Egyptians used sand to help build the pyramids. The Mayans and the ancient Romans used sort of primitive forms of concrete that was based on sand. So we've been using it to some extent, and glass, you know, we've been digging up sand to make into glass since before recorded history. You know, there's glass, decorative glass beads have been found in ancient Egypt, in the ruins of ancient Egypt, and ancient Palestine. So we've been using it for a very long time. What's really changed, though, was the introduction of modern concrete. That's when the sand industry really exploded. Went from being a pretty small, you know, it's kind of a niche industry around the world, to being the number one construction material on Earth.
And when was that exactly?
So that's just around the turn of the 20th century, like in the very early 1900s. So it's quite recent that we've really started using concrete. So concrete has a bit of a history. Like I said, it was used in ancient Rome, other places, but it really, like, it sort of disappeared for about 1500 years until around the mid late 1800s, when sort of inventors and tinkerers kind of rediscovered it and started playing around with it, trying to figure out how to use it as a building material. And so it was sort of growing. People were starting to use it for things like sidewalks and in a very, very limited way. But a lot of folks saw the potential. And one of them was an architect named Ernest Ransom. He was a guy who came over from England, emigrated to San Francisco in the late 1800s at a time when San Francisco was just booming. It was the tail end of the gold rush, the beginning of the silver rush. There was lots of money pouring into this place. And then as now, there was a lot of, sort of entrepreneurial zeal matched up with all this money. So Ernest Ransom was experimenting with these different types of concrete. And he really perfected the idea of reinforced concrete, which is basically just putting steel bars inside the concrete. I can go into the reasons for that, but in a nutshell, you do that, you make your concrete much, much, much stronger. And we're still using that method today. If you go by any construction site, you'll see the first thing they do before they pour concrete is they lay down a lattice of steel bars. Anyway, Ransom came up with this system, steel reinforced concrete, and he thought, this is it. I mean, this stuff's amazing. I'm gonna make a fortune. But he had a really hard time convincing anybody to actually use it, right? Because at the time, everybody was building with the tried and true methods like bricks, stone, wood. The tallest building on the planet was about 10 stories high, right? It was a brick skyscraper. And people just looked at him and said, why should we take a chance on this crazy new material? You know, like, no, we're gonna stick with what we know, and what we know works. But Ransom persisted. And he managed to get a few buildings built around the country, around the United States, out of concrete. And a couple of them were in San Francisco. This is important because in 1906, San Francisco is hit by one of the biggest earthquakes in its history. Massive earthquake that triggers enormous fires. Basically, the entire city is leveled to the ground. Thousands and thousands of people dead. And when the smoke finally cleared and the dust settled, guess what was among the very few buildings still standing? Ernest Ransom's concrete buildings. So people took a look at that, and that was a big turning point. All of a sudden, people were like, wow, that stuff, I want my building to be built out of that stuff. And from there, concrete just exploded. And, you know, like I said, it's now by far the most widely used building material in the world.
Now, how did they originally get the sand? Because I assume that the industry is a lot different than it was 150 years ago or so. So what was it? What was the mining of the sand originally like?
Yeah, so it's actually changed less than you'd think. It's still a pretty low-tech industry. And the reason for that is it's not, mining sand is pretty easy, you know, comparatively speaking. So basically, like I said, so all the sand that we want has come down from mountains, flowed along with rivers and out to the sea. So how do we get that sand? So we can dig up that sand in any of those places where the rivers have left it. So like I say, so a lot of it's on the bottom of rivers, on river banks. And over time, over centuries and millennia, rivers sometimes flood and flow over their banks, or they shift their course so that they end up leaving big deposits of sand in what's now dry land. So the easiest way to get sand and what we've been doing, you know, for basically since the invention of the steam engine, is you just take a big old boat, a big barge type boat, send it out to the middle of a big river like the Mississippi or, you know, the Mekong or the Nile or whatever, drop a big suction tube, a pipe down to the bottom of the river and just suck it up, like sucking up, it's like a giant straw. And you just pull that sand up, you got a boatload of sand, you're ready to go.
Well, I assume that wasn't how it was like in 1800s, though, was it?
So back then, similar methods. So it's everything from like mechanical dredgers. So like basically just like a big claw that you would attach to the back of a boat and just drag it along the bottom of the river and haul it up. Or they had what they call a bucket shell, like these sort of conveyor belts with buckets on them. that would go down to the bottom of the river, scoop up a bucket load of sand, and then come back up, dump the sand, and then go back around the conveyor belt. Those started really very early on, as soon as they had steam engines, they started using that. But still around the world, you still have sand being harvested literally by hand with just people, you know, shovels, buckets, people going down to the local riverbank or the local beach and just scooping it up by hand and loading it into the back of a pickup truck or even onto donkeys to haul away. So it runs the gamut, right? So it's everything from that, from, you know, literally just a guy and a shovel and a donkey to today we have these gigantic dredging machines, ships, right, that can go out and scoop up enormous amounts of sand. So the biggest sand dredger in the world today is, if you took a 60-story apartment building and tipped it over on its side, the ship would be a little bit longer than that, and it can hold about 80,000 tons of sand at a stretch.
Now, this might be a stupid question, but I'm going to ask it anyways. So you need sand for concrete and everything that you've listed so far. But what's separate? Why not dirt? Because you were saying sand is just like crushed up rocks, and I don't know what dirt's made out of, but maybe you do.
So dirt, basically, the reason is, think about holding a dirt in your hand. It's really soft, right? Mm-hmm. Dirt is basically like decomposed organic matter, plants and living things that have broken down. Sand is rock. Sand is tiny, tiny little rocks. If you keep, you know, trying to crush down dirt, it'll crush right down until it's just mud and dust on your fingers and it's gone. Sand is a tiny little rock, right? So it's imagine trying to, you know, if you mix dirt with water, you just get mud.
Yeah. Right?
And your dirt will just flow away. You mix sand with water and a little bit of cement to glue it together, you get concrete. It's basically just hard, right? Dirt, mm-hmm. dirt is not hard. It's a different substance. Sand is little bitty rocks. It's very hard.
Okay. So how much of sand is replenishable? Like, is it a natural resource like oil or coal, where basically you take it out of the ground and it's not coming back?
It's a lot like that. So just like coal and oil, the planet is constantly making new sand. Right. Like I said, we're always eroding mountainsides, or nature is always eroding mountainsides, but it happens very slowly. It happens on a geological time scale. So for all intents and purposes, as far as we humans are concerned, yeah, it's basically non-renewable. You take it, it's gone.
So I know that with diamonds, there's this industry that's developing where they can make artificial diamonds, quote unquote, but it's diamonds that are they're solid carbon. They're actual diamonds, and for all definitional sense. And is there any way that you can actually manufacture sand in that sense, like speed up that process in a lab or any sort of industrial setting?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That's a good question. So yeah, of course you can manufacture sand, and there's a pretty big business around the world in doing that in places where they've run out of naturally occurring sand. You just, you know, you crush down, take a big rock, smash it until all you've got left is little tiny rocks. So you can do that. And as I say, people are doing that. There's two big problems with it though. One is it's very expensive, right? If you imagine how much energy it takes to crush a granite boulder down into grains of sand, it takes a lot of energy, which means it's expensive. Two is that the sand grains that you get at the end of that process aren't exactly the same as naturally occurring grains. Why? Because they haven't been through that long, long erosion process. So they're often actually too sharp, too angular. They're not quite the right shape. They work for some things, but not for every application that we want to use them for. So it works, but the sand that you get is not as good quality wise, basically, as naturally occurring sand. B, it's more expensive.
Okay. So then, do we normally get our sand now from rivers, like you were saying, or where, and I know you had said before that it also comes from oceans and everything. So where does most of the sand come from? And also, is there a specific country that is, like, you have Saudi Arabia and all these like countries that are zeroed in on one specific resource. Are there any countries like that where their main resource is sand?
Not really. So the thing about sand is, you know, it's everywhere. This is one of the reasons everybody uses it, is because you can find it in pretty much every country in the world. Mm-hmm. Pretty much every state in the United States has at least some sand. So, so there isn't a whole lot of international trade in sand either. Reason being that it's, sand's very heavy, right? A cubic yard of sand weighs about a ton. Mm. And you need, you know, millions of tons of sand to build, you know, a skyscraper or a dam.
That doesn't seem like a lot of sand for that much weight.
No, well, it's very dense, right? Yeah. It's very heavy stuff. And so as a result, it's really expensive to transport. So if you have to haul it any great distance, the price of it starts to go up really fast. So that means the builders always want to get their sand somewhere close by. So where do they get it? To get to your next question. I should say, actually, there's a little country called Barbuda. It's in the Caribbean, not Barbados, Barbuda, which is a little island that has sold almost all of its sand to neighboring countries like the Bahamas, because they need sand to replenish their beaches. Their beaches are disappearing, they're eroding, and Barbuda, which is not a tourist island at all, has basically just like made the choice of literally selling their land to their richer neighbors. Wow. And that's really left them vulnerable to climate change. Now they're starting to get into some serious trouble. But anyway, that's kind of a side story. So the question of where people get all that sand from. So one of the most common ways, for sure, like I said, is river sand mining, right? It's the sand that you get from the bottom of a river. It tends to be really good quality. It's nice and clean. It's easy to get. It's cheap to get, but it can be extremely damaging, right? So you think about what happens. You send a boat out into the middle of a river, drop that big pipe down, suck up all the sand that's on the bottom of the river. Well, first of all, anything that was living down on that river bottom, any kind of shellfish, or plant life, anything like that, there you've just annihilated their habitat, right? It's completely gone. Second is, when you tear up the river bottom like that, you stir up all the other muck and mud and silt and whatever was down there, and that clouds up the water, right? All that junk comes up into the water, and that can literally suffocate anything that's swimming in that water, right? Any fish, you know, again, or shellfish or plant life that's swimming in the water, they can literally suffocate on all the sediment that's now floating around up there. Three, that sediment blocks the sunlight from getting through, from shining through the water down onto underwater plants, corals and other kind of plants that grow under the water that need sunlight to live. So that kind of river sand mining can and has done tremendous damage to the environment. It's wiped out mangrove forests, seagrass beds, it's done serious damage to coral reefs, fish populations, to the populations of birds that live off the fish that live in those rivers. It's a major, major problem around the world. And as a result, in some places, like in many countries in Western Europe, they've actually banned river sand mining. They don't allow it anymore. Hmm. United States, I should point out, does permit it.
So where's most of that sand in America being mined?
I mean, really, you name it. Pretty much any major river around the country is probably being or has been tapped at some point for sand.
I've never thought in my life that I'd spend this much amount of time talking about the importance of sand in my like. It's just it's amazing. But I want to talk about that you're saying about Barbuda, how they're mining all their sand. So is that their beaches that they're taking it from?
Yeah, it's the coastal sand. Yeah.
Yeah.
The beaches. And basically they made the decision, like, it's a small island. I think their only other export is phosphate or something like that, some other like natural mineral resource. And for whatever reason, they just never developed much of a tourist economy, you know, which is what drives most of the other islands that are around them, right? They're right near the Bahamas and Bermuda and all those famous, you know, tourist islands. They didn't have much going for them, except they do have a lot of sand, very high quality beach sand. So they've been selling it to their neighbors for quite a few years now. And as a result, their coastlines, their coasts are much smaller than they used to be, which means they're much more vulnerable to ocean rise as climate change kicks in, and also to storms, right? When big storms hit and those storm surges come in from the ocean, you want a nice big fat coastline to, you know, absorb some of the impact of that storm before it, you know, gets to where people live, before it hits people's houses and roads and all that stuff. And there in Barbuda and in other places around the world, they're doing the opposite. They're shrinking their coastline because they're literally selling it off.
Huh. Now, I assume it's not that big of an island either.
It's not that big of an island. No.
Yeah. Okay. And this makes me think of the whole like fishing industry, how you have oceans that are just being depleted from any sort of life at all. And that's mainly because there's no, like, if the US wanted to put regulation on fishing, which I'm sure they do or whatever, but they, you go into US waters, you can only do a certain amount of fishing or quotas or something like that. But you go into international waters and there's virtually not much, to my understanding. And I assume it's the same case with sand, is it?
You're right that there are no rules about harvesting sand in the open ocean. The good news is there isn't that much of it going on because it's quite expensive, right? Because you need a big ship to go quite a ways off coast. Mm-hmm. That said, the ocean sand mining that has been done in the last few years, some of it has caused tremendous, unbelievable damage. And the biggest example of this is in a place called the Spratly Islands. So the Spratly Islands are this little archipelago, really just a bunch of collection of rocks that sits in the South China Sea, kind of right in between in this very, very strategic waterway that's very close to China, the Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia. I'm forgetting all the countries off the top of my head, but basically there's about half a dozen countries that sort of ring around the South China Sea that all claim these little rocks because a huge amount of the world's shipping passes through that. It's a very, very important shipping lane. And also there's a lot of oil and gas underneath the ocean, billions and billions of dollars worth of oil and gas down there. So for quite a few years, all these different countries were jockeying for who gets to claim these Spratly Islands, these little rocks. China, about 5 years ago, has been building up their dredging fleet, and they now have the biggest fleet of dredging ships in the world. And what they did is they sent that fleet out into the South China Sea, dug up millions of tons of sand from the bottom of the ocean, dumped it on top of the Spratly Islands, and literally created new islands, created these man-made islands where there were no islands before, on top of these rocks and coral reefs, and built military outposts on them. And now China has soldiers and fighter aircraft and warships on these man-made islands, which gives them... So first of all, the process of doing that, they annihilated huge amounts of coral reefs. It's the biggest destructions of coral reefs in history, like in one shot. Wow. Just buried them. The other thing that makes it a real worry is it puts China in a very strong position if they ever wanted to, they could cut off, they could use those bases to just, you know, to blockade this shipping lane and just cut off a really important international shipping artery. So it's caused a lot of friction between the United States and China over the Spratly Islands. And there's been a lot of tension and some little clashes there. And it's this ongoing source of tension.
Yeah. One thing else you mentioned that I saw in your TED talk was how, was it China has gone through more sand in the last, like, or not, maybe you can correct me, like 4 years or something like that, or I don't know how long it is, 20 years, than it had been, had the U.S. gone in the last 150 years, basically.
Yeah, it's that China, all by itself, China used more sand, more cement, concrete, sand, in just a few years. I think it was 2010 to 2014. In those few years, they used more sand than the United States used in the entire 20th century. So every street, every sidewalk that was built in the United States between 1900 and 2000, think about all of that. China used more than that just in the past decade, just in a few years.
Yeah, they have more people. So you'd think also that it would be, it makes sense that it's just growing faster. Anyways, yeah. Are you going to say something? You want to add something?
Well, yeah, they do have a lot more people. And it's also just that the speed at which China and the rest of the developing world is urbanizing, that's the really key difference, right? So like I said, like we were talking about before, concrete really took off and became, you know, around the turn of the beginning of the 1900s, the early, you know, around 1910 is where concrete really starts to spread all over the world. But at first, it was mostly in the rich world, in Western Europe, North America, you know, where the rest of the world took a while more to catch up. It's only been in the last 30, 40 years as China's economy has really started to explode. India, Indonesia, Nigeria, all these parts of the developing world that have really taken off in the last couple, three decades. Now that's created this enormous demand for sand. So it's many, many more people moving into cities, which are made out of concrete, like we've said before. So you have people, many, many more people moving into cities than ever before and doing it on a much faster pace than ever before. So right now, I mean, to give you some perspective, in 1950, only about 750 million people worldwide lived in cities, right? Lived in environments made of concrete. Today, the number is about 4 billion. And it's increasing by tens of millions every single year. We're adding the equivalent of 9 New York cities to the planet every single year.
And that's a lot of sand as well.
It's a lot of sand.
Wow. Yeah, so I was going to ask, this might be the same thing. But so, yeah, I might just, okay, let me ask the question first. So how much is the industry of sand growing throughout like the past, like, I don't know, in recent, like, I don't know, in the past, like 30 to 40 years, but I might have an answer to that question myself on how, you can tell me how I'm right, but as population grows or as people become more urbanized, that might be a direct correlation, I imagine.
So you're almost certainly right. We don't know for sure, right? There's actually nobody really knows exactly how much sand is being used and how much the industry is growing and how much it brings in. And the reason for that is because it's only pretty recently that people have really started paying attention to it as a commodity, right? So unlike things like coal or steel or cement or oil, there's no international body that keeps track of how much sand is dug up, how much sand gets used, nothing like that. Some countries do it a lot. It's like we have pretty good numbers for the United States in terms of how much sand gets used every year, but worldwide it's really all it's estimates. But the amount that the best guess is the amount of sand that we use, I think, has about tripled in the last 30 years. And again, now it's 50 billion tons of sand and gravel every year. It's the most consumed natural resource on Earth, after water.
I was going to say if it's more than water, but not even coal or oil or anything like that?
More than coal, more than oil, more than wheat, more than rice. Yeah.
So by weight,
sand is number one solid resource.
There's more demand in sand than actual food, essentially, right?
Yeah, that's one way to think of it. Yeah.
That's crazy. I want to know if you could talk more about the consequences of all this sand mining, environmental. And I also wanted to ask you as well, is there any other consequences besides environmental damages? And I assume also there's damages of, like you said, that people have been killed over sand.
Yeah, so absolutely.
That's a little bit of questions there, but you can go take what you will with that.
Sure. So we talked about the environmental damage that happens. And that's in rivers, that's beaches being stripped bare, that's habitats for animals being destroyed. But it also causes a lot of harm to human beings, right? So this happens in many ways. So first of all, in a lot of places where rivers are being heavily sand mined, that can really mess with people's drinking water supplies, right? Because it literally lowers the water table in the rivers, right? If you're scooping the bottom out of the river, the water's dropping lower. That's made riverbanks collapse in some places. So you literally have people's homes, farmers' fields have literally just collapsed into rivers that have been heavily mined. In some places, it's meant that drinking water supplies have dried up because of the impacts on rivers. In some places, you dig down the river. So you've got got the ocean here, you got rivers here. Rivers flow to the ocean because the ocean is downhill from them, right? But if you keep digging and digging and digging those rivers out, eventually they're below, they start to get below sea level. And at that point, seawater starts flowing into the rivers full of salt, which kills all your crops, right? So if you've been mining, if you've been farming land alongside a river near to the ocean for generations, all of a sudden, and this is actually happening in some places, all of a sudden, the water that you use to water your plants with is full of salt, and that'll kill your plants, right? Plants can't stand salt water. So it's having a lot of, it's doing a lot of damage to people's livelihoods in that sense, right? It's doing damage to crops, to drinking water, to the physical places where people live. And then there's the crime piece of it, right? So in dozens of countries around the world, there is a black market in sand where organized criminal gangs dig up tons and tons of sand illegally without permits, without permission, and sell it on the black market. We know for sure that's happening all over the world, including, not to a great extent, but including even in the United States. And in some places, it's gotten to such an extreme that you have like serious criminal gangs who are making really big money at it and do what criminal gangs do everywhere to get away with it. They bribe police, they bribe government officials to let them keep doing what they're doing. And if you really get in their way, they will kill you. So as I say, hundreds of people who've tried to interfere with the illegal sand mining trade have been murdered. And we're talking about, you know, local activists just trying to preserve their own villages' fields. We're talking about journalists that have tried to expose it. Government officials, in some cases, even police officers, people have been shot to death, hacked to death with machetes, burned alive, run over with trucks. And there are hundreds and hundreds more who've been assaulted, had death threats rained against them, the whole gamut.
That's crazy. And you mentioned about how farms like are being essentially destroyed in some areas over the salt water being brought in, also the how the rivers are collapsing. So are there any specific countries where those are impacted the most?
So that kind of thing is happening in many, many countries around the world. There's definitely a lot of damage of all these kinds of damage that we're talking about in India, right? That's probably where the most violence is. There are dozens and dozens of people have been killed just in the last couple of years. You know, every week or two, there's a sand-related killing in India. Crazy. Yeah, which is amazing to think about.
Sand-related killing. I've never thought I'd hear that phrase in my entire life.
I know. It's crazy, man. Like I said, that's exactly what got me started was that exact concept. I was just like, how can this possibly be? It just seems crazy. But then you start looking into it and you realize how important sand is and it all starts to make sense. Anyway, so we know there's a lot of violence and a lot of destruction being done in India. I don't want to say that India is the worst for it because part of the reason, well, the main reason that I know that is because India has a very lively, free press, a lot of which is in English, right? So it's pretty easy for, like, there are a lot of people writing about it, a lot of journalists and researchers and so on, and activists working on the problem in India, and they publish their findings in English. So that makes it easy for a guy like me to find out about. For sure, you know, there's the same kinds of thing is going on in many, many other countries. I don't even know most of it, right? Because I don't speak every language in the world. So I monitor what I can. So I know for sure, for instance, that people have been murdered over sand in Indonesia, in Kenya, in Ghana, in Mexico. That's guaranteed to be just the tip of the iceberg, right? Nobody knows how much more is going on in other places around the world.
That's crazy. So what are the solutions to this problem of using too much sand? Also, is there a way that we can maintain the same level of growth in urbanization throughout all different countries without destroying the oceans, the riverbeds, and propagating gang violence over sand?
Short answer is, I think the answer is yes. I think we can. And I like the way you phrased it, because really the question is, the question shouldn't be, well, how can we use less sand, right? Really, because like you say, we know that we're running out of so many other things at the same time, right? We know we're cutting down too many trees, taking too many fish out of the oceans, burning too much fossil fuel. And now come to find out we're running out of sand, the most abundant thing in the world. Well, to me, those are not separate problems. Those are all symptoms of the same problem, which is just that we're consuming too much, right? We, and by we, I mean we in the rich world, the Western world, and the growing numbers of people in the developing world who live the way we do, right? With detached houses and cars and flat screen TVs and all that good stuff that we all enjoy. The world just cannot afford, a world of 8 billion people just cannot afford for everybody to live that way. There's just not enough stuff in the world. There aren't enough raw materials for everybody to have that standard of living. We have got to find ways to live our lives and to build our cities, which is where most people now live, in ways that consume not just less sand, but less of everything. And I do think that that's doable. I do think it's possible. And to my mind, the easiest and one of the most effective ways that we could address that problem, including sand, is by looking at cars, looking at the automobile. And you might say, well, what do cars have to do with sand? Well, if you think about it, if we could reduce car ownership by just 10%, right? Take the number of households in America, in the world, that own cars, and reduce that number by 10%. What would that mean? That would mean that 10% of all new households, of all new homes that you build, don't need a garage and they don't need a driveway. And again, that your garage and your driveway are made out of concrete. A single garage takes about 100 tons of concrete. So right there, just by not having a garage and a driveway, you've saved over 100 tons of concrete. It also means if you're building a shopping mall, an office park, whatever, you can shrink the parking lot by 10%. Think about how the gigantic parking lots that every major city has there, everywhere. If you could shrink all of them by 10%, again, that's thousands, millions of tons of sand that you're saving by not having to build all those parking spots. And that is on top of course, all the carbon all the carbon emissions reductions that you get and all the other resources, right? All the metal you don't have to mine, all the rubber you don't have to tap, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We could save enormous amounts of natural resources and help the climate problem by reducing car ownership. And that is not that hard to do, right? Where I live right now in Vancouver, they've put a hell of a lot of effort and energy into making the city easier to get around on by foot and by bicycle. So I grew up here, moved away for about 30 years, just moved back. I am amazed at how easy it is to get around on a bicycle because the city's basically built this network of interconnected, protected bike lanes so that it's safe, and easy to get to work, to get to school, to get wherever you need to go on a bicycle or on foot. And as a result, just as a micro example, my family went from being a two-car family when we lived in Los Angeles to a one-car family. And we don't have a garage or a driveway anymore. And you know what? We're fine. We get everywhere we need to go. Life is great. And I'm just as happy not to have that extra car.
One thing though, is you had said before when you started this, that you don't want to look at it in a sense of like, oh, we need to use less. But isn't that a sense of if you're using less like materials to use, like you're not having parking, garages, cars, isn't that a sense of reducing your like resources that you're using?
Oh, yeah. No, what I meant is the question isn't how can we use less sand, but how can we use less of everything?
Okay, I see what you're saying.
The key is we do have to use less. We have to use less sand and everything else. But the trap that we often fall into, right, is, you know, you hear about these problems like, oh, my God, we're taking too many salmon out of the rivers, to pick an example, you know, up here in the Pacific Northwest where I live. So people say, oh, we should stop eating salmon. well, salmon's actually a really good food, you know, and a lot of people get their livelihoods on it. And we should continue to use salmon, but we have to use less of it. We can't have, you know, we can't consume the amounts of salmon that we're consuming now, or beef. Another good example. Like, beef is fine. I'm not saying everybody has to stop eating beef, but we do have to stop eating so much beef, right? You can't have, you know, a sausage patty for breakfast and a hamburger for lunch and then a sirloin tip for dinner, right? 8 billion people cannot live in a world like that. But we can live in a world where you eat beef like once a week, you know, or twice a week or whatever.
Yeah. So, and then also one more thing is that, well, two things before we have to go is that when you say we could use less cars and everything, part of the reason we have cars and everything is because our cities are very spread out. And losing less cars would mean you have to compact the cities more. And wouldn't that mean if you compact the cities more, you're going to have to build more higher buildings and more compact buildings? So would it, in a sense, maybe end up using more sand?
Not really, because you'd have to build higher buildings, but you don't need as many roads to service them, right? If you think about the suburbs take miles and miles of highway. You got to build freeways to get out to the suburbs, and then out in those suburbs, every single home has a driveway and a garage and, you know, probably a patio out back and all that kind of stuff. So you're right that you'd end up, you know, the amount of concrete that you're using in sort of in the city center is more, but it's more than balanced out by the concrete you're not using building those suburbs. It's just way more efficient for people to live close together and share, you know, because an apartment building, like a high-rise tower, and I'm not saying everybody has to live in a high-rise tower by any means, but I am saying, you know, lots of people do, lots of people are into it, and it's a much more efficient way to live. Like, it's much easier to get power and heating and, you know, the other things that you need to live. It's much easier to do that for 100 people who all live in the same building than to 100 separate houses.
And then also with there's this argument to all the running out of resources dilemma, whether it's trees, whether it's you're putting too much CO2 in the atmosphere, climate change, or water, or whatever it might be. There's people that make the argument of adaption, that it's sand is a good thing to grow our society, that it's helps us in a major way, makes our lives better, and although we that brings a lot of problems, we should still continue on the path we are and just adapt to the consequences that it brings. What would you say to that? Or,
well, I think that's true. I mean, concrete is a really good building material. There's very good reasons why we use it so much. It's cheap, it's easy to work with, and it's provided housing for, you know, cheap, affordable, quality housing for billions of people around the world. That's a good thing. But the adaptation piece of it is, we have to recognize that, you know, there are costs that come with it, and that we cannot continue to consume it to the extent that we are now. And so we have to adapt by figuring out ways to use less of it and figuring out how to get it without causing so much damage. Otherwise, you know, we're all going to wind up in trouble.
Yeah.
Right.
And then also, would you say, everyone says, oh, the next war is going to be fought over water and everything, and wars have been fought over resources our entire lives, or in our entire human existence. And do you think that we could see the next wars being fought over sand?
I don't think so. Mainly because there's so many other resources that we're going to come to blows over first. Like, I'm much more worried about water. Water is a much more urgent issue than sand. Sand's a big problem, but I mean, we're running out of drinking water really fast, and it's already, you know, sparked it. Like, water shortages are part of the reason, part of what drove the war in Syria, or part of what drove the war in Darfur in Sudan. So that's already happening. And, you know, water is something you need every single day, right? If you run out of water, you're going to know about it. Your people are going to know about it that day. Right. Whereas if you run short of sand and you have to put off building, you know, that new apartment block for a couple of weeks, it's going to, you know, people have time to adjust and to figure out, and it's not quite as urgent a thing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't think we have to, that one thing we don't have to worry about with sand is wars.
Well, thank you so much, Vince. This has been an absolute pleasure. I can honestly say this is probably one of my most enjoyable and fun podcasts yet, because.
Oh, thanks.
I never thought I could talk this much or hear someone talk so much about sand. It's such an interesting topic and such a unique perspective. I've never heard someone have this, this viewpoint. It's very enlightening. Thank you.
Well, thanks. I'm very flattered. Yeah, it was great to be here. It was great talking to you.
Yes. And is there any place that people can find you or find your work?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, the book is called The World in a Grain. I'm just blanking on the name of my own book. The World in a Grain, The Story of Sand and How It Transformed Civilization. You can get it off Amazon or your local bookstore, anywhere books are sold. My website is just vincebeiser.com, vincebeiser.com. And you can go there to find out more about the book. My Twitter handle is just @vincebeiser. Sign up for that if you want to, you know, sort of keep up to date. And yeah.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was Vince Beiser. And thank you so much. And maybe we can talk again sometime.
Sounds great. Thanks,
Alan. Have a good one. Bye-bye.
You too.